Would you stand with me and let's read our memory verse together and pray over what we'll be able to hear tonight and for God to speak to us. Would you read that, 1 Peter 2? But you are a chosen race,
a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for God's own possession, so that you may proclaim the excellencies of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light.
Dear Jesus, we are so thankful for your word. We are thankful that every time we open up your Bible, Lord, that we hear exactly what we need to hear. Lord, speak to us tonight. Speak the words that you know that only we need to hear. Move ourselves and our desires and any other thoughts out of the way so that we are focused only on your words, Lord. Thank you for this moment and for this space we have to learn. We pray this in your name. Amen. You can have a seat. So you had a lot of heavy reading this past week, and there's a lot of the story that we skipped. So in like 5 to 10 minutes, I'm going to really quick go over several of those things and just talk about some of the big takeaways from those moments. One of those moments is when the Israelites receive God's 10 commandments. I don't think that was part of your reading, but it's important to know that Moses went away from the Israelites for an amount of time and then receives the law and receives the 10 commandments. And if you get a chance, read through Leviticus and read through the story of the 10 commandments and the laws, because I know when you hear Leviticus, it's not everyone's first go-to book of the Bible that you read. But I promise you, you will, if you intentionally go after that, God will reveal to you something through that. And I know when I first read it, I went, whoa, this is really cool to learn all the laws and all the sacrifices and the feasts that they were to celebrate and the reason for that. So if you do get a chance, I encourage you to read that because it is pretty fascinating. So the Ten Commandments God gives to Moses, and he's away from the Israelites for some time. When he comes back is where we're going to sit for just a second. When he comes back, he sees that the people immediately start rebelling. What he sees is this image, this golden calf, and everyone's dancing around it, including his brother and his sister, Aaron and Miriam. And we see them having this celebration, this fire. And it's interesting when Moses comes down and he speaks to Aaron, what in the world is going on? And Aaron's first response is, I don't know, everybody just threw that into the fire and then this big calf came out. What? No. They started thinking Moses forgot about them. Well, he's been gone for so long. Where is he? He's not coming back. He must have died. So what are we going to do? So they decided, instead of waiting, they decided to take matters into their own hands. And where did they go? Back to what they knew. They went back to idols, and they went back to sin because that's what they knew. Immediately, Moses comes down, he sees them, and he becomes so angry, he throws the stone tablets that God had written with his finger. He threw them down and shattered them. He was so angry at them because they weren't willing to listen and to wait on God. And then the story goes on. God pardons the Israelites again. Their lives are spared. Many of them not. Many of them perish through big devastation that God brings on them. But Moses goes back up to the mountain and receives the Ten Commandments again. God takes the time to give them back to them, which is just like God. It is just like God. The whole story of the Moses and the Israelites, I just sit back and I said, That is just God, who God is. Forgiveness and grace and mercy. It's so amazing because that's us. Like we said, that's us. And so later on, God instructs them to build the tabernacle. The tabernacle to me was one of the most fascinating parts of the story, to learn that each piece is specific. And there's a reason for this piece, and there's a reason for that room, and there's a reason that they use this type of material. One piece I want to talk about specifically is there was a veil, a huge veil, a literal piece of fabric that they had put up in between the place where God stayed and then where everyone else could go. There was a veil. You couldn't go in there because God was there. There were certain rituals and practices that you had to do to make yourself clean, to even go near that. And at times they would tie a rope around the priest's waists, and they went just in case they dropped dead, they could pull them out. Not anyone could just go in. When Jesus died on the cross, I want you to turn with me to Matthew 27. This is great. There's a veil separating us from where God stayed, from where God dwelled. And in Matthew chapter 27, verse 50, says, "And Jesus cried out with a loud voice and yielded up his spirit, and behold, the veil of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. The earth shook and the rocks were split." At that moment, when Jesus took his final breath and died on the cross, the veil to the temple was torn, which means I'm no longer separated from you. Anybody can come in. Isn't that awesome? It gives me chills just to think about that, that no one could come in. And in the moment that Jesus died, in that moment, while we were sinners, while people were mocking him, and when he was on the cross, the second he took his final breath, the curtain was torn, and he says, "All are welcome in my presence because I am the Lord." I love that. I love that. We can get to that place. The veil is torn. It's still torn. And we can get into that presence of the Lord. But we also need to take the step into surrendering our whole selves to him. Not just part, not just in this area, not just over there, our whole selves. With our heart, with our thoughts, with our mouths. In Numbers 12, we learned that Miriam and Aaron got themselves into trouble with their mouths. They didn't have self-control over their mouths, like I tell my students, self-control over your mouth. They were very quick to go aside from the rest of the group and to start gossiping about Moses and his wife. They became jealous of Moses because God only spoke to Moses face to face. God only spoke to Moses. And they got jealous. They said, "Weren't we leaders too? Aren't we just as important too?" Moses didn't hear them. But it says, the Lord heard it. He called them all together, and he explains the situation and says, "I've heard you, and you're not doing this against Moses, because I have chosen Moses. You're doing this against me." And so we learned that there was a punishment, the consequence, that Miriam was sent away for 7 days. She was leprous, and so she could not be around the rest of the camp. They camped for 7 days. After she was clean, God did restore her. God did restore her, and they were able to pack up and move their camp. But the reason Moses, which is where we're going to camp out today, Moses intercedes for her. Moses pleads on Miriam's behalf that God would heal her. And so Miriam, I want to say she learns her lesson. I hope she did. To use your words, and I think as women, we get kind of caught in the middle of that because we learn very quickly our words are powerful. And we have a very specific, we're wired in such a way where, you know, women, we talk a lot. We talk. And I know in the job that I have, it's a lot of women, and we talk. And sometimes it's not very good talk. There's a lot of gossip that goes with women. There's a lot of bashing that goes along with jealousy or fill in the blank. And it happens. So when we surrender those thoughts, because Jesus tells us even when we have those thoughts in our head, when we have those thoughts, it's still, in that case, a sin. And so when we surrender our thoughts and we think only on good things, Ephesians 4:29 tells us to think only on good things and let no unwholesome talk come from your mouth. I think as women, that needs to be written on our hearts. Let no unwholesome talk come from our mouths. So let's go to, excuse me, let's go to Numbers chapter 14. I know you read this for your homework this past week, either yesterday or today. So in Numbers 13, just one chapter before, Moses sends out 12 spies to go spy out the land of Canaan. They are right there on the edge. They are on the edge of Canaan. They are ready to go. And the people immediately, in their nature, start to have second guesses about what's going on. Well, how do we know that it's really good? Well, how do we know that when we get over there, we're not going to die? Well, how do you know? How do you know? How do you know? So Moses gets really flustered with them. And he decides to appease them by saying, fine, we will send some people to go spy out the land. So he sends 12 men, one from each tribe, to go and spy out the land to really make sure that it is what God says it is. Moses doesn't have doubts, but the people have doubts. So in order to keep them happy, okay, fine, we'll do this. So he sends out the spies, 12 of them. In chapter 13, spies come back, and they're given two reports. The one report says, yes, the land is great. It is flowing with milk and honey like God says it is. It is good for food. There is a lot of land. It's beautiful. It's gorgeous. It's great. And then the rest of the group says, yeah, but there's also really strong people who live there. And it's going to be hard to defeat them. And their cities are really strong, so I don't know how we're really going to get in. Which group of people do you think the Israelites believed and agreed with? The negative one. So they become really frustrated. They become really angry. Chapter 14, verse 1. All the congregation lifted up their voices and cried, and the people wept all night. All the sons of Israel grumbled against Moses and Aaron, and the whole congregation said to them, would that we had died in the land of Egypt, or would that we had died in this wilderness. Why is the Lord bringing us into this land to fall by the sword? Our wives and our little ones will become plunder. Would it not be better for us to return to Egypt? So they said to one another, let us appoint a leader and return to Egypt. So here we are again, complaining again, grumbling again against Moses and Aaron. And really what they find out is they're not trusting God enough. It wasn't Moses and Aaron who led them there. It was God who led them there. We learned last time that God led them there for a purpose, was for them to fully trust in his goodness and in his grace. But they had to go around the long way to get there. And here they are. So at the chapter, let's see, verse 4, it says, they decided to appoint a leader and return to Egypt. So they were kind of done with Moses. They were done. Well, Moses led us here to die. So let us choose someone, because our choice is better than God's choice. Let us choose someone, and then we'll just go back. After all the time that they've spent and all the obstacles that they've overcome, after everything that they've seen God do, there's still, no, our way's better. Let's go back. Let's choose. Who wants to do it? Any takers? Not me. Numbers 14, chapter 5, I'm sorry, verse 5. Get those confused. Then Moses and Aaron fell on their faces in the presence of all the assembly, the congregation of the sons of Israel, Joshua, the son of Nun, and Caleb, the son of Jephunneh, of those who had spied out the land, tore their clothes. Joshua and Caleb were two of the 12 spies who came back. They were the two that talked about how great the land was. They were the two that said, God has chosen good for us. It's great, it's good. Joshua later becomes the leader of the Israelites after Moses and gets to lead them into the promised land. And because of what the Israelites were doing, Joshua and Caleb, they went into this whole, they tore their clothes and they were mourning in front of the congregation because, no, what are you doing? This isn't right. And so the very next line, it says that they spoke to the congregation. The land we pass through to spy out is an exceedingly good land. If the Lord is pleased with us, then he will bring us into this land and give it to us, a land which flows with milk and honey. Only do not rebel against the Lord, and do not fear the people of the land, for they will be our prey. Their protection has been removed from them, and the Lord is with us. Do not fear them. Joshua and Caleb are trying to tell them, no, God has told us what's going to happen. God is good, and God will get us through that because he promised it. He said that, yes, they're strong. He's not saying they're not, but he's saying God has made us stronger, and he will provide a way. Very next line says, but the congregation said to stone them because of what they said. And then the glory of the Lord appeared. Two responses happened because of the Israelites' rebellion. They want to kill the people who have told them that, no, it really is good, I promise you. Their response is to kill and to do away with them. And then God's response is, he comes down. It says the glory of the Lord comes down. So he's decided, I've had enough of this. I am coming down right now, and we're going to handle this situation. And so we have to think about how we respond to situations like that. How do we respond when life gets hard? How do we respond when A, B, or C happens? I know for me, my husband likes to make fun of me because if something happens, and then I just roll it deeper and deeper and deeper and deeper, and then I'm like, and then we're all dead. What? it's unreal. And the Israelites do that too. Well, it's hard, so we might as well just go back and die. What? They were not living a life that was consistent with what a surrendered life should look like. Their life did not show, and even though they probably thought they were, they probably thought for a while that they had it all figured out because things were going well. There's the promised land. It's right there. But think about this. Is it consistent with a surrendered life to be unbelieving? Is it consistent with a surrendered life to threaten to harm another believer? Now, I know we don't threaten to kill each other when we don't agree, but harming as in gossiping, or harming as in saying hurtful things to someone else. Do we long for death or long to go back to where we were because where we are right now is too hard? Is that a surrendered life? To want to go back to the old way because it's too hard? Do we think that our way is better than God's way? Is that consistent with the surrendered life? going our way, not trusting God's decisions, not trusting in God's chosen leaders. That's hard. God has put people in powerful places where we have to surrender to that. And is our life consistent with surrendering if we are not obeying God's chosen leaders? That can be hard too. Is our life consistent with the surrender life when we complain when it gets hard? So Moses had a response. God's response was, he is now coming down. Moses also has a response to this, and it's beautiful. I'm in verse 11. The Lord said to Moses, "How long will these people spurn me? And how long will they not believe in me? Despite all the signs which I have performed in their midst, I will smite them with pestilence and dispossess them. And I will make you, Moses, into a nation greater and mightier than they." Sounds pretty good to Moses. God says he's done. I'm done. I'm done putting up with the Israelites. Time after time after time after time, I pardon them. I'm done. I'm just going to get rid of them. And I'm going to start over with you. The next Abraham, if you will. He will be the new, greater father of greater nations, more nations. And I'm sure Moses is sitting there going, sounds good. He will be famous. People will know him. Sounds pretty good. But listen to Moses' response. Verse 13, Moses says to the Lord, "Well, then the Egyptians will hear of it. For by your strength you brought up this people from their midst. And they will tell it to the inhabitants of the land. They have heard that you, O Lord, are in the midst of this people. For you, O Lord, are seen eye to eye, while your cloud stands over them, and you go before them in a pillar of cloud by day, and in a pillar of fire by night. Now if you slay this people as one man, then the nations who have heard of your fame will say, 'Well, because the Lord could not bring this people into the land which he promised them by oath, therefore he slaughtered them in the wilderness.'" So Moses starts speaking to God and kind of calling him out on his power, calling him out on his promise and saying, "If you don't do this, then everyone's going to know about it. And everyone's going to say, 'Well, wait a minute. Why did he bring all the Egyptians, or I'm sorry, the Israelites out into the wilderness just to kill them? Surely they will hear about it. And then what's going to be of your name? You're going to be the God who can't keep his promises. You're going to be the God who couldn't deliver the Israelites. What will they say?" And I'm sure God's not worried, because nothing surprises him, which is always true. Nothing surprises God. Even to this day, he is never concerned. He is never worried. He knows everything that will happen. He knows. And that should be our comfort. Moses begins to plead for the people by saying, "What will happen if you just get rid of all of it and start over? What will happen?" So in the next few verses, verse 17, he says, "But now I pray, let the power of the Lord be great, just as you have declared." Now he's speaking to God's power, and he's reminding God of what he had just said to them not that long ago. He said, "The Lord is slow to anger. He is abundant in loving kindness, forgiving iniquity and transgression. But he will by no means clear the guilty, visiting the iniquity of the fathers on the children to the third and fourth generations. Pardon, I pray, the iniquity of this people, according to the greatness of your loving kindness, just as you also have forgiven this people from Egypt until now." So Moses now speaks to God about what he has said himself. "Didn't you say that you were slow to anger? Didn't you say that you're abundant in compassion and mercy?" And God's going, "Yes. Now you are who I want you to be. Moses was transformed into this person who has now cared for other people over his own desires. That was God's plan. He offered him this nation. He offered it this abundant, greater, mightier power nation. He offered that to Moses. Sounded pretty darn good. And Moses said, no, these people are your people. We've been through all this, and I want them to go. Moses is now concerned for everybody else over his own desires. That's surrender. That is powerful. And ultimately, that's what God wants for us. He wants us to surrender our own desires, surrender our own thoughts, our own success, our own ambition for Him. Because then when we do that, then He says, my plan for you is always greater. So whatever you thought your life was going to look like, oh, get a load of it over here. Greater. It's greater. He desires that for us. Philippians 2, verses 3 and 4 tells us to do nothing out of selfish ambition and that we should think of others as greater than ourselves. Matthew 5, 44 says to pray for our enemies and for those who persecute us. That's hard. Luke 23, verse 34, these are Jesus' own words. When he was on the cross, when he was dying, part of his final words where he says, Father, forgive them, the people who are harming him. Forgive them, for they know not what they are doing. He is the ultimate act of intercessing for us. And we are called to do that for others. And when we surrender those own thoughts of me, myself, and I, we can now start thinking of other people. Because that's who Jesus was. Romans 8:29 tells us that we are constantly being transformed into the likeness of Christ. That's God's plan for us, is to be the image of God. That's how He created us. He created us in His own image. And that image is all about other people. That image is not about me. It's about others. It's about God. And when we can surrender that and when we can see that, it's huge. Because then it's about the kingdom and it's about God's name and it's about everything else, and we get to play a part of that. So we learn God's response in verse 20. He says, I have pardoned them according to your word. But indeed, as I live, all the earth will be filled with the glory of the Lord. Surely all the men who have seen my glory and my signs which I performed in Egypt and in the wilderness, yet have put me to the test these 10 times and have not listened to my voice, shall by no means see the land which I swore to their fathers, nor shall any of those who have spurned me and see it. But my servant Caleb, because he had a different spirit and has followed me fully, I will bring into the land which he entered, and his descendants shall take possession of it. So God's response is just like God. He says, okay, they're pardoned. They can go. But also, there has to be some kind of consequence. Not everyone gets to go. And that's fair. But God says, those who have fully surrendered and those who have done good, they get to go and enjoy it. That's exactly who God is. That's what He tells us to. We do good and we transform ourselves and we surrender and we get to experience that. And then we get to pray for others and we get to help each other. Because God tells us to be in in fellowship. And he tells us that we are not to be on our own. But what's interesting about this is there's an argument against it, which God is not a puppet either. And I can't just say to God to do something that I want him to do and he will do it because he hears me do it. Yes, he did that when he spoke with Moses, but that was his plan all along. Moses didn't change God's plan. Moses changed as a result of God's plan. Moses changed who he was. And we get to do that too. We don't understand. We don't understand prayer. We don't. But that's not the point. We don't understand how God works, and we're not supposed to understand how God works, and that's something that we can ask him when we get up to heaven. We can ask him those hard, hard questions of why and how and why did you do that? And prayer, it's not a game. It's not something that you say, I want this and this and this and this and this. God will gladly do things for you because he has and he does. But it's ultimately his plan. But that shouldn't stop us from prayer, because prayer is communicating with him about our hearts and about his heart, and we hear from him. Praying for others on their behalf. I know that I have a group of friends who we can text each other late at night, early in the morning, and I know that if I don't have words to say, they can pray for me. And the Israelites didn't have the words. They didn't know. But Moses knew what to ask of God. And the Israelites benefited from that. In the moment that I realized my story of surrender, when I was back in college, I had big control freak about having to control everything in my life. And I remember the moment that I realized that surrender was what was needed. I didn't have the words. And I remember sitting back in the backyard of the retreat center, they had this big oak tree, and I remember sitting back there, and I had my hands really closed. It was bad. I had my hands closed, and I just knew, I didn't know what to say, and I was sitting with my husband, then boyfriend, and he prayed for me. His words. I didn't know what to pray. And I remember looking at him saying, I don't know what to pray. And he said, open up your hands. I opened up my hands. And then he prayed for me because I didn't have the words. And we can do that because we don't always have the right things to say or the words to say, or they just don't come to our mind. And God doesn't say, well, don't know, so I'm not going to listen. That's why we need each other. That's why we transform ourselves into Christ's character, because he cares about people. We should care about people. When we push away our desires, when we push away these thoughts in our head of what am I going to do and where am I, we start to see Jesus, and we see others like Jesus did. And it's beautiful, and it's hard, and it's great. Would you pray with me, please? Jesus, thank you for the gift of prayer. Thank you for friendships and relationships that when we don't have words to say, that someone else can step in and pray on our behalf, Lord. And I pray over each person in this room, Lord, that you would bring someone to them that can be that. Because I know not all of us may have that. God, would you bring people together? That is your greatest joy, loving you and loving people. God, would you just speak to our hearts this week as we read your word and what we need to do to surrender our lives and where we need to surrender. Jesus, thank you. As we examine our hearts, Lord, would you soften our hearts and open our guards so that we can fully submit and say the things that need to be said, Lord. Push away anything that the enemy is trying to lie to us, because he will try, Lord. Keep him from us. Let us only hear you and your voice. Thank you for this space. Thank you for this time that we get to speak and hear from each other, and that we get to share what we're learning and things that we need from you, Lord. Thank you for that. I pray all of this in your name, Jesus. Amen.